Welcome to October 1st. Can you believe it? We're in October already. My God, I looked at the calendar today. You know, I was still in September, and I thought, wait a minute, we're in October already. Interesting. And I think the rest of this year will fly by. Of course, I want to comment on a few things before I bring my guest, Mia Feroleto, onto the show. I did some polls today on Facebook. I wanted to know your opinions. And, of course, we know that I have to laugh. The government's, what, closed, shut down today? I mean, just retarded, absolutely nonsense. But anyway, you know, I was saying a week ago, people were like, oh, the government can't close. I'm like, why not? Close them down. Interesting stuff, though. The whole Obamacare or the Affordable Health Care Act, whatever you want to call it, and some of the comments. So I just wanted to report back to all of you from the polls that we did and what your response was. And hello, chat room. How you doing? I'll drop some links in for you, too. And if anybody wants to go and add your vote to the polls, it's on the Roxy Lopez page on Facebook for those of you who are already members of that. Okay, so what ended up happening was, of course, the government shut down today based on a lot of stuff. What can I say? You know, they've been kicking the can down the road for a long time. So the proverbial can. So one of my questions was, are you a fan of Senator Ted Cruz of Texas? And if any of you know Senator Ted Cruz and what he's doing and the part that he's playing at the moment, un momento, por favor. He is to be somebody who's fighting for the people. But anyone in Texas, and I've spoken to a few people in Texas, can't stand the guy. Of course, he's supposed to be like, quote unquote, a refreshing senator because of his stance. Anyway, regardless, let's see, out of 20 people that commented, most, the higher percentage of you said, you're not a fan of Senator Cruz. I asked some of you why. Some of you gave some reasons. One of them was because he's a paid representative for the Koch brothers. I don't know about that. I don't know too much about this gentleman. And somebody else said that they didn't like the support, his support on their approach to oligarchy. And if you know what oligarchy means, it means the power that effectively rests with a small number of people. And of course, we're referring to government, which is exactly what we have. But the gentleman didn't want to go on with the debate as far as it went. So I have to count on him for another day. He didn't want to explain exactly what he meant. And then, of course, most people answered it that they don't like politicians, period. So they threw the baby out with the bathwater, and that's what the general consensus was. The next question in the poll. Oh, and somebody just posted because they're crooked. The next one was Republicans in the House of Representatives refuse to fund the government unless we defunded or dismantled the Affordable Care Act, which is Obamacare. And I asked, are you for or against defunding of Obamacare? And out of about 16 or 17 comments, most people were in favor of defunding. One person was in favor of keeping Obamacare, but I couldn't get the answer out of them why. But 99% of you said no, you weren't for Obamacare or funding it. You were for defunding it. So I think that's interesting. The next poll I did was, the healthcare law is, in quote unquote, is the most insidious law known to man. And that is a quote from Republican Representative Todd Rokita of Indiana. And I asked if you disagreed or agreed with that statement, which is Obamacare is the most insidious law known to man. Now, there were a lot more comments on this. So an average, 45. 50, maybe 60 now, maybe more, maybe 70. Most people agreed with the statement. A couple of you had some very interesting comments. I want to quote what Stephen Forrest said. He said he somewhat agrees with the statement. Forcing us to pay high premiums for insurance is somewhat insidious, since it does not work to reform health care or insurance, but rather to saddle us Americans with yet another cost outside most people's ability to pay. That seems to be the number one reason why citizens here don't care for the Affordable Health Care Act, because it's tied to taxes. I'm in agreement with that. If you don't buy it, you get a tax penalty. Kind of weird, huh? I think that's kind of weird. Anyway, it has some good, Stephen Forrest goes on to say, it has some good benefits for those people living in states that did not decline the Medicaid and Medicare expansion and allow those pre-existing conditions to be insured rather than the companies dropping those people. But it does create such a bureaucratic nightmare that Mr. Forrest can't see how it would be possibly a positive step towards solving the problem we currently have in our healthcare system. I have to tend to agree with him there as well. It needs to be cleaned up and streamlined. But Obama seems to think he doesn't need to do that simply because he doesn't want the Republicans to win any points with the voters. Thank you, Stephen Forrest. I thought that was a fairly – that's one attitude. Brittany says, I think the Republicans complain about everything but can't come up with solutions. Democrats can't get anything passed or sell ideas. Both parties are useless, and they should all be fired. They don't serve the people whatsoever, because if they did, they would realize that healthcare is a basic human right, and you shouldn't have to pay to survive, especially when the corporations are the main ones keeping us all sick. The only thing I disagree, and thank you, Brittany Mabane, for the comment, I don't know that it's a human right, a basic human right, but it should be. Our health should be a concern, and I don't know that it's a basic human right, but that's okay. Brandon Gray said, yes, he feels that it's insidious, but he disagrees that it's the most insidious law in the books. But Brandon didn't further comment to tell me what he thought was the most insidious comment. So thanks for your comments on the polls there. A lot of you had some really insightful answers. And of course, my next poll was, with the government shutdown in place today, how do you feel about Congress continuing to get their paychecks? However, 800,000 government employees will not receive a paycheck or back pay. Of course, they have to negotiate the back pay at this point because they don't know if they're going to get their back pay, that. Well, majority of you, let's see, I don't know, 50, 60, 70, 70 answers on that one, were disgusted, just flat out disgusted. Which tells me that people are just giving up on any opportunity to make a difference. I love what Vampstress Rising Star said. Vampstress Rising Star. She says, I say it should start top down on paychecks, even if they reduced President, House, Senate, and Congress paychecks 90%, they would still survive. So she's saying, yeah, she should start from the bottom up and cut the checks or cut them in half or what have you, give them little pay, and that they'd still survive. That's a pretty good point, too. I don't think any of the people in the House or the president – by the way, the president, is, as far as I know as of today, it makes about $400K a year, and he's not getting any of his checks interrupted. That's nice. What was another interesting one? But, you know, for that one, the majority of you – were just flat out disgusted, pissed off that, you know, we don't even understand how these people get their paychecks. Somebody did ask who writes the paychecks for all of those in Congress. Who write, do they, and they asked, do they write their own checks? That's a good question. I don't know the answer to that. I doubt they. And of course, Faith Marcus commented, revolting, not surprising. Yeah, I think so. A few of you said it's time to change, it's time for change. And I asked the question, who's going to change it? You know, it's interesting that I don't think citizens in this country get that you and I, as citizens, we are the governing powers. We are the government. We are the boss. They are our indentured servants. We pay their salaries. and they're not going to change anything. I mean, they're liking what they're getting. You see what I'm saying? They're now just fighting amongst themselves. You know, we're not even involved in this. It's as if we're invisible, we the people. Seriously. The change is going to come from us, but that's just my opinion. I don't know why the change would come from government. It can't. We're just watching the dog and pony show is all we're doing. But anyway, I want to thank everybody for the great answers and for the polls. And most of you are just fairly as disgusted as I have been. And none of you are even taking the – I think a lot of you, according to the polls, are not really taking the shutdown very seriously. And, of course, what do? They go after, you know, national parks. And I thought this was interesting. They had on the news this morning that if you're staying in a national park, you know how you go and you camp for a month or a week or whatever, and you pay, you know, to go and camp in some of the national parks like Yellowstone, let's say. You, as of yesterday, you had 48 hours to get out of the park. Or I guess they're sending, this is what they said on CNN, that they'll send in somebody to bodily remove you from the park. Just crazy stuff. I wonder if you get a refund. That'd be a good question. Anyway, my guest today, you know, we're right along the subject lines of injustice, banksters, the whole nine yards. We have Mia Feroleto back. You know, she's just brought up so many interesting things on the past couple of shows that she's been on. The show that we had planned today migrated into another area, so it's not what we had talked about the last time she was on, but that's okay. As you well know, she is a well-known art advisor, activist, and artist who lives in New York City. Well, she doesn't live in New York City anymore, in New York State. She was the creator of ARTWALK NY, now a national event that opens well-known artist studios to the public to raise money for the Coalition for the Homeless and other causes. Ms. Feroleto is a committed animal rights and animal welfare proponent. She is determined to maximize visibility for the arts and cultural world and is currently developing the Adopt an Artist program to send artists to destinations around the globe in order to create art. Shamanic work, Reiki, and other healing modalities are incorporated into her work with artists and animals. Mia's goal is to focus public attention on the crucial need to provide unwanted animals with safe, healthy, and loving homes. She was blessed to live in the country with a pack of six dogs, all rescues, two horses, three cats, and that's where she learned that the intersection of art, nature, and animals opens each of us to the divine and our own special spiritual nature. The current exhibit, we're going to talk about that today, and it's very interesting. The story is very interesting. I've heard it. I don't know. I guess I know everything about it, and I'd like her to share this with you, which is the water exhibit. We're going to talk about this from beginning to end. Very interesting. And for all of you out there that have anything similar happening to you when you hear this story, you will be inspired as to what steps to take. Mia, join us. How are you?
Roxy, hello. How are you?
Pretty good. What did you think about my polls today?
Amazing. Well, I think today is a really come to Jesus day for Americans as we watch our government shut down and 800,000 of our fellow citizens being left unemployed, as you say, while our elected officials continue to collect their paychecks and benefits and have vacations and everything else. So it's it's a mirror to what's actually going on. And my hope is that it finally provides the motivation for people to stand up and say, you know, I've had enough. This is not acceptable. And it's time to change. It's time to change the way things are being done in this country.
Yeah, it is. And, you know, I think another one that people are fairly upset about as well, which it bugs me too. I mean, they're not very transparent about all this stuff, for one. You know, that everyone in government or, you know, Congress, what have you, and you know, they're exempt from what they're putting on us. They're exempt from the law, the
right.
Obama, you know, the act, the Obamacare law. They're exempt from it. And you know, if they don't get a plan or whatever, or, you know, a healthcare plan or whatever, they're not going to be taxed, you know, because they're our servants, you know, see, basically public servants. I'm really tired of the people are damned. We, the people, are damned if we do and damned if we don't, yet they seem to get the benefits on all sides of every coin.
Well, how about the fact that we were all supposed to be microchipped by March of this year, you know, as part of Obamacare? You know, that bill was signed into law as well, that, you know, all of our information would be on a microchip, so that we could be tracked. I mean, we're already tracked by our passports and our driver's licenses, but we'd actually have a chip inside of us that contained all of our information. It's
fine.
Pretty scary stuff, and
yeah,
it's really past time that we all start, you know, voicing our opinions and taking a stand. It's not going to happen until we do, and you know, it's winter's coming. You know, this is not going to be the winter of our discontent. We still have warm weather for the next couple of months, and especially in Washington, and we need to start converging on Washington and making our voices heard.
Well, I know a couple of weekends ago, there was, you know, the 2 million biker ride to D.C. Of course, it laid real low in any mainstream news, and now I don't know how many truckers, but there's a whole truckers organization, and now I think it's either next weekend or the following week, the truckers are now going to drive through D.C. in protest of just about everything. And I think that's interesting because there's no real mainstream coverage on it. Another interesting thing that happened to the truckers is on September 22nd, which is really recent. What is that? Last week? Facebook removed the truckers' Facebook page with 86,000 likes on it. Facebook removed it.
Wow.
Okay, because that's how much, you know, awareness they raised. And political opponents attacked the truckers to shut down America page within days, and they exploited a little known to the public feature on Facebook and YouTube and Twitter called community standards flagging, which allows them to instantaneously shut down an account on these social media platforms, you know, and that's what they gave them as an excuse.
Wow.
You know, that, you know, via this law or whatever. It's just crazy stuff. And so I don't know if they have their Facebook page anymore. I don't think they do, but I'll put a link in here for the chat room if you guys want to take a look at that. The truckers are basically, no wonder they're kind of worried about these guys. They want to impeach Obama. So they want
a lot of people want to impeach
awareness.
Obama.
Yeah.
I think there are plenty of people in the military who want to impeach Obama as well. On the one hand, he had all of the you know, emotional, political, goodwill capital that anyone could possibly possess shortly after his election, and he didn't take advantage of it. And on the other hand, the Republicans are making it impossible for him to do anything. But he's not a consensus builder. He's, you know, he's an intellectual. He's detached, and it's beneath him to get out there and hobnob with the people and build consensus. And this is what we have as a result of that. So he hasn't been a very effective president. And
he's been effective, all right.
Well, on the negative, but not in terms of doing, you know, anything positive that's going to help, you know, the average American improve their lives in any way, shape, or form. Yeah, he's been effective in terms of rolling out the you know, quote-unquote agenda, certainly.
Sure, sure. You know, and back to the truckers, you know, they also have been working with a bunch of other organizations as well. And what they were planning on doing is not only driving in their trucks and waving, flying, you know, the American flag. They considered it to be a very patriotic day for the truckers, waving the flag. And they were also, this is also combined with people who are going to be on the overpasses, on all the freeway overpasses, you see, flying flags as well. And between the two groups that have put this, you know, the whole organization together, the two organizations that joined together, they figured that they would, you know, it would make a stance and I think they also wanted to make sure they got on the news. And, you know, doing this across the country, it should be on the news. I mean, it should show up on the news. It'd be very interesting if it doesn't, because they really didn't do a whole lot of coverage. I mean, minuscule coverage when the 2 million bikers cruised out there. By the way, some of them had flags on their bikes and things like that. So, you know, I think people are waking up. And I love that the bikers and the truckers, you know, started something, you know, that, and maybe it's going to be a situation where, you know, another organization and another organization. So all I can say is to the people of this country, you know, if you have a motorcycle or you have a truck or you want to be in a convoy or you want to, you know, you want to join up with organizations like this who are really, I mean, it says a lot to me that truckers. It says a lot to me.
Well, they're every man. Truckers, yeah, and bikers, they represent, yep, you know, quote unquote, every man.
That's right. The working man.
Right.
So I think that there's a lot in our very near future. Go ahead and take a look at that link and pass it around to people, because we can all get involved in this one with the truckers, because it's cross country and they're going, like I said, they're going to DC. And I really do wish them luck. I'm going to try to get a hold of their organization too. I want to speak to them. So anyway, we'll see what's going to happen. But as far as anyone that always says, you know, yeah, we need change, we need this, we need that, you know, we the people are the change makers. That's who we are. We're it. And until our country gets a clue about that we are it, we are the ones who make the change. We are the ones who don't comply with things that we don't want to do, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Yes, I know the big bad military's out there too. I know the FEMA camps are, you know, I got a report out of Nebraska. And this guy had given me information about a FEMA camp, you know, kind of snuck by a hill and took photos of this whole FEMA camp, oh, about 2 years ago. And he says there, you know, it basically was brand new. They built it and it was all guarded off and nobody's really there. Well, they're loading it up with staff right now in the last couple of weeks. And the
right.
Pouring in. So, you know, and I know that this is happening all over the country, but, you know, people, we can't react to this. You know, another thing that people are doing that I think is really nuts is take all your money out of the bank because blah, blah, blah. Listen, you look at the Cyprus model and five other countries that follow the Cyprus model that's coming to our town soon. You know, if you got $100 in the bank and you hear that they're going to, you know, reduce the amount of money that you've got in the bank, which is what they did in Cyprus, let's say 20%. So $100, that would be 20 bucks. You wake up, you know, Monday morning, you've got 100 bucks. Tuesday morning, you've got 80. Listen, if you go in and if you took the $100 out the day before, you didn't escape anything. All it means is your $100 only has $80 worth of buying power now. So if you take your money out, I mean, we're not even working on a money system anyway. We're on a cashless society anyway. It's been set up that way. Our money means nothing. You know, our coins, our paper cash, whatever you want to call it, it's not worth anything. We're not trading with that. That's not our currency anymore. Anyway, it just looks like it because it's something we're used to doing. You know, we were raised in a country that money actually meant something and coins meant something. A quarter was a silver quarter and was worth the silver that it was made out of. So I'm not going to get into that because that's not what this show is about today, Mia.
No, we're going to talk about This Is Water and
yes.
And David Foster Wallace, actually, to begin with.
Yes, but listen. We got about a minute till break.
Before break, okay.
Yeah, we got a minute before break. So I'm going to ask you real quick if we can hold off till after the break.
Absolutely.
So that we can tell a whole story, you know what I'm saying?
Absolutely.
We need to tell that whole entire story. But while I do have you on the air, you know, about animals, you know, Mia's got some animals and one of her animals had some problems, but when her dog's named Ruby. So I'm going to ask you, how's Ruby doing today?
Oh, Ruby's fantastic. Ruby's like a new woman. I call her my wild woman. And we did energy work, and she had this big growth in her ear. And all the time, she's 12 and a half. All the time, she's just sitting up now because she knows we're talking about her. All the toxins in her body.
During the break, so we can hear you coughing.
Oh, I'm sorry. I'm sorry, everyone.
That's okay. There was no way I could tell you because the commercials were going. I thought, oh my gosh, she doesn't know she's live on the air. But just a reminder. So let's talk about the exhibit. Can we talk about how it started, how you put it together, where it was, and the people, the players involved?
Well, I'm not going to mention any names or a specific place. You have the exhibition on your website, so anybody
yes.
who wants to go can go. I was asked to put together this exhibition by the founders of a new startup arts organization, and originally they were thinking that it should be a watercolor show, and the idea of just doing traditional watercolors had little intellectual or emotional appeal, really. So I started thinking about the whole issue of water, and knowing that we're going through a grand water trine right now, astrologically, with all the water planets involved. I started thinking about water and the fact that water is such a unique element, and that our bodies are made up of such a large percentage of water, 73%. And I started to think about it not only as a medium in terms of watercolor, but also as a subject matter and as an intellectual idea. And I happened upon a speech that David Foster Wallace gave at Kenyon College as the 2005 graduation address called This is Water. And all of your viewers can go to YouTube and watch the speech. It's had over 4 million viewers to date. For those who don't know, David Foster Wallace is considered to be one of the top 20 writers of the 20th century. And he suffered from depression and was on antidepressants and was having trouble with them, and tried to wean himself off of them. And then when he was having severe trouble with depression, he went back on, and he found that the medication no longer worked for him. So in 2008, and on September 12th of 2008, he took his own life. And I think, you know, my sense is he just had enough. You know, this was one of the truly brilliant minds of the century. He influenced a tremendous number of contemporary writers and artists and musicians and all kinds of people. And quoting from Wikipedia, according to Wallace, fictions about what it is to be a fucking human being, and he expressed a desire to write morally passionate, passionately moral fiction that could help readers become less alone inside. In his Kenyon College commencement address, he described the human condition of daily crisis and chronic disillusionment, and warns against solipsism, invoking compassion, mindfulness, and existentialism. The really important kind of freedom involves attention and awareness and discipline and effort, and being able truly to care about other people and to sacrifice for them over and over in myriad petty little unsexy ways every day. The only thing that's capital T true is that you get to decide how you're going to try to see it. You get to consciously decide what has meaning and what doesn't. The trick is keeping the truth up front in daily consciousness. And, of course, he's talking about our own personal individual truth, because that's all any of us have, really, to go on in our lives. So I started to think about him, and I started to think about how the artists use or envision water, both as topic and subject matter for this exhibition. And I put together a very eclectic group of artists, some of them being very famous and established, like Don Nice, and two of them actually being only 2 years out of an MFA program, Amelia Tolke and Kylie Wolgamott. And the you know, the pieces range from Antoinette Grassi, who used Hurricane Sandy as subject matter on two drawings that include the phrase submerged in one and washed up in the other. It just ran, you know, a wide range of subjects and imagery, and also how the artists would use the work, you know, use the subject in terms of their work. So the show is beautiful, you know, absolutely beautiful, and the opening was incredible. A number of people said it was the best contemporary art show they'd seen in the state, and we had a very large number of people come. Half of the artists showed up. And there had been issues, you know, I was working as a consultant and had curated this exhibition on request, and my name is exhibited with the exhibition. My name is printed on the invitation, and in some of the articles that have been written already, I'm listed as the curator. And the people at the organization had, in fact, in August, tried to take the show away from me. And then just a couple of days after the opening reception, they did, in fact, take the show away from me. And what's interesting to me is all I could think of was David Foster Wallace and the fact that he had reached the point in his life where he had just, he'd had it, you know. He definitely suffered from depression, which fortunately I do not, but he obviously had multiple experiences in his life where he wound up being disappointed, you know, disappointed intellectually, disappointed by his colleagues, you know, in the education system. I mean, a man like that looking at the current education system could only feel, you know, frustration and disappointment, and the fact that learning had become such a commodity, you know, where our students are paying, you know, $40,000-$50,000 a year to go to school, accruing, you know, hundreds of thousands of dollars in debt that they never will have the opportunity to dig themselves out of, and, you know, student loans just went, the interest on student loans just went up, and you know, how do we expect to build a new America if our young people cannot have access to an education? It's just ridiculous. But I think he and Hunter Thompson and, you know, a number of other people just chose to check out because they'd had enough, you know, it was just too hard. And these are the people who have the brain power and the sense of community and a bigger life of what's beyond, who can actually, you know, institute change in not only in themselves but in the people around them. So, it's fascinating to me that that my experience with this is water became this vehicle of change. And what was so interesting is two of the top artists in the show were supposed to give a public address. I was supposed to be the moderator for, I'm a painter myself, for the three of us discussing the topic of painting and their own paintings. And they were told that, you know, that their talk would go on with the founder of the organization, and they respectfully declined. And a very well-known artist from New York, offered to write to all of the other artists. She offered to withdraw her work from the show, and she offered to contact all of the other artists. And for the famous artists, you know, to pull work from a show would not make it, you know, it would not matter at all. But for the younger artists who were delighted and happy to have a chance at exhibiting and possibly making sales for all of them. You know, that didn't seem right. And so I said, no, let's keep the show, intact. But what was really funny, I walked out to the Extra Mart, this morning at 6 o'clock to get some milk for my coffee. And I noticed they still have my sign up. And, you know, as I've told them, and as I've been told by, you know, a very well-respected curator, the exhibition is in fact my intellectual property, and they've taken my name off of everything else, but they have my name on the show in the gallery still, and it can only be that they were advised legally to leave my name with the show because, you know, otherwise I'm sure they would have taken it down also. So I, you know, we have a new moon on Friday. The new moon is in Libra, which is all about balance, but it's squaring Uranus, which is, you know, totally unexpected, you know, can be explosive change. So all of us are either going to take this energy and harness it and really use it to create a new balance, or else there's going to be explosive situations going on around us. And I know that there are a lot of people that they feel they have the upper hand, and when they feel they have the upper hand, they choose to take advantage of that regardless of whether or not they're squeezing someone else. And, you know, artists are the visionaries. Artists are, you know, current day shaman who are leading the way for the rest of us and showing us, you know, what is possible. And I found it absolutely wonderful and beautiful that these, I received two letters this morning from artists in the show of, you know, supporting me. And I just think it's, I just think these issues are being fought, you know, or resolved, perhaps is a better word, very much on a personal level. But again, because we're, you know, we're quote unquote ascending, you know, consciousness is flowing into our being, very beings at this moment in time, our personal experiences are very much influencing the quantum field as well. And, you know, I find that really fascinating. And in a very interesting way, I feel like I'm, you know, taking my stand and standing up to the banksters and the politicians and, you know, all the other people in power and authority who are, you know, basically screwing with our lives, but and don't really care about it. And you know, the perfect reality and metaphor for this is the government shutting down today.
Right. It is interesting. You know, I'm looking. I put a link in the chat room for everybody. To look at the art that we're talking about. Mia, you still here?
Yes.
Okay, great. You got really, really quiet. How beautiful. Okay, so the page that of the art that you're referring to in this is water. And I found Washed Up by the artist, is that Antonietta Grassi?
Uh-huh. She did that piece in response to Hurricane Sandy.
That's a great one. I actually would have this in my house. Interesting. And then how, look at the names of the art. See, I was married to an artist at one time in my life, and I learned a lot about what an artist goes through. Me being a musician, it's not that far off when you're a creative artist. And it's so interesting, this one by Karen Gunderson, this called Starfish Below.
Isn't that an amazing piece?
Oh, it's amazing because I was hearing
black.
It. Yeah, I was thinking, what's it made with?
She only uses black paint. That's a solid black painting. It's all done with texture, and it so much connects to the divine feminine. Actually, Karen Gunderson and I have been friends for 30 years, and she's the artist who offered to pull her work and write to all of the other artists asking them.
Is that right?
Well, yeah.
I love the name of it and Starfish Below. So while you were, you know, expressing, you know, everything that had happened, I'm looking at this beautiful piece. Is this a large piece, by the way?
That's a small piece.
It looks
that
huge.
That's a very small piece, but she does make them huge, and they're incredible. You feel like you could just walk right into them.
Yeah, and I found the starfish in it. I was like, why does she call it Starfish Below? What is she talking about? And go ahead and look at that, people, because you can actually, you'll see it, you'll find it. I think it's incredible, and the creative aspect is what it is. I love artists, and I love to go to galleries, and I love to go to like the exhibit you just did, because you do, when you exchange a glance into a painting, your mind starts to go. I mean, it's not just about the picture, the painting, is it? There's something else that starts to happen. It's very stimulating, isn't it?
Well, a real work of art has real psychic power. You know, there's no question about it. And years ago, I worked for an African art dealer, a very high-end African art dealer, and I'll never forget the first time I walked into what was to be my office with all these African artifacts, and I literally jumped out of my skin. I jumped because these pieces, you know, some of them were rubbed with blood, you know, for a variety of reasons in terms of imbuing them with, you know, even more power, and bones and shells and all kinds of natural elements woven in. But they really do possess power, and a painting can move you, you know, in all kinds of ways, emotionally and psychically. The first painting I ever sold, I'll never forget, I was a junior in college, and I had to have a student exhibition as part of my degree. And I had this room off the library, and I had, I don't know, five or six paintings hanging in there. And this wonderful young guy from Yale Divinity School fell in love with one of my paintings, and he bought it for $500. It was my first sale. And he wrote me the most poetic letter telling me how much he loved to sit and watch the sun change on the surface of the painting, and how it influenced his consciousness and his spiritual awareness. And, you know, it's just an extraordinary experience for me as a young woman.
Sure. And then you also got paid for what you did, which is amazing. I experienced that with I don't like to call him my ex-husband, because I don't think anybody that's still in my life and part of my family, we just didn't work out as a marriage, but he also did that. He also, and I remember when I met him, he had these little blades next to, you know, it's this huge, huge art studio. And he painted gigantic art. Like it could be, you know, a freeway sign. I mean, just huge art. And he had these little blades on the tables everywhere. And I said, what are these little razor blades? And he turned his arms around. Take it whatever way you want it, people. And he had all these little tiny scars all up and down between the wrist and the elbow. And I said, what are you doing? And he said, I always put a little bit of blood into my colors, my paint.
Oh, how interesting.
Yeah. And I thought
he was putting his life force into it.
Exactly. And I said, oh, you're weird. That's weird. I go, oh, that's so weird. And he said, no, actually, it's not, you know, blah, 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 blah. And he explained it very intellectually to me, actually. And I still thought it was weird. Don't get me wrong. I thought it, because he had all these little tiny white scars, like all over. I just thought it was very martyrism kind of thing. And he laughed and said, oh, God, no. It's you know, that's where he took it from, his arms, and that's it. And his parents didn't think it was weird. So I thought they were all weird. But anyway, it turns out it wasn't weird. And you're one of the first people that I've heard describe that again. So,
well, conceptual artist Chris Burden from California, amazing artist, would lie in an elevator without moving for days on end and leave push pins with a sign that said "push a pin into me," and the whole point of the conceptual piece was to see what you know, humanity, how humanity would act. Would they actually, you know, take advantage of the situation and do a sadistic act, or would they just, you know, think of it as an intellectual thing and consider it that way? You know, it's, we see examples of the best and the worst in people every day. And right now it's just all so pronounced that, you know, we have to ask ourselves, you know, how would we react if we were in this situation?
Right. Well, and I do agree with you about the arts in general that are, it's always visionary. It's, you know, music's ahead of its time as far as, you know, what the lyrics are about, what the songs are about, but it's always 10 steps ahead, art ahead, prophetic, profound, as well, you know, always has been, always will. What's so interesting, and I don't know, you know, with the artists that you deal with, maybe you could share, you don't have to name names, but with the artists that you deal with in general, are any of them rich? The artists themselves?
Oh, some of them are extremely wealthy, and, you know, in the 80s, art became a lot about fashion and style, and that was when artists, you know, the careers of artists became something else, you know, became about celebrity as opposed to just being stashed away in your studio and, you know, working. I mean, someone like Van Gogh, I think he sold one painting in his entire career. And then you have an artist like Damien Hirst who staged his own auction at Sotheby's and raised, I think it was $120 million, auctioning off his own paintings. So it's fascinating to see how art has been commodified, and real art cannot be commodified because real art belongs to everyone. Real art is the fuel, the rocket fuel, so to speak, that propels all of us into a better place. And, you know, the real artists know that about their work. They're doing it because they're compelled to do it, because they can't do anything but do their work. And, you know, regardless of the medium, whether it's music or you know, painting or writing, you really feel the urge, and you're absolutely compelled to follow your muse and manifest what's coming through you at the time.
Right. Yeah, no doubt. It's channeled, you know, a lot of artists that I worked with over the years, musicians, we all agree that it's channeled.
Mm-hmm.
It's you know, it's like the, you know, someone wrote a whole song in 5 minutes at Denny's on a napkin in the middle of the night. It's channeled
right. Stuff,
you know, it just comes to you. You know what I mean? It's like, wow, wait a minute, you know. The worst songs I ever wrote were the ones that I took so long to write. Like,
mm-hmm.
just had to go in and fix and do this and do that. And at the end of the day, you look back at the original jotting down of the lyrics and the melody line, and that was the song. And I don't know what I did to it. I ruined it, you know, later on down the road. And art can get ruined. I mean, music can get ruined by producers and people who come in and think it should be this and think it should be that. And, you know, and at the other end of the spectrum, good producers can actually come in and magnify what your intention was and make it even more, you know, louder and better and whatever, you know what I mean, the message. So it is interesting. And art in itself is truly of the beholder, you know, it's what one, it's interesting how you can like a certain style. You know, Andy Warhol sticks out in my mind as somebody who really blazed, you know, the 60s and 70s, early 70s with, you know, this whole magnificent, crazy pop art, you know, I think he invented it, didn't he? Cultural map?
He was definitely one of the ones who, he started out, doing windows at Tiffany's, designing windows at Tiffany's, and he started out with these, you know, simple line drawings, beautiful simple line drawings. I had curated a pop art show for a museum a number of years ago, and what's interesting about the pop artists is they really stuck to their guns in terms of what they were, you know, about. They stayed on track and continued to develop their work along the lines that they first conceived of it, which is quite interesting. You know, they didn't jump around in terms of what was stylistically in vogue. They just stayed true to themselves, and they were, they were revolutionary at that time, which is very cool. And ask the viewer to look at a box of Brillo or a can of Campbell's soup and see the beauty in it, change the context and think of it in a new way.
Yeah, he had the famous Campbell's soup pitcher, and I don't know what he sold it for, but it over a million, you know. It's like, it's just crazy stuff. But yeah, but at the same time, you know, anybody that, like I said, they blazed the, you know, the what was hip and turned the norm, I mean, a Campbell's soup can, for crying out loud, turned the norm into something that was just like, I gotta have it, you know, kind of a thing. But art does speak to you. You know, I was in a photography. We've kind of left that out, but photography, another art. It's the art. It's the eye behind that camera. You know, you can always, like Annie Leibovitz, let's say. You know,
right.
you can see that it's her. You can see it's her because she is the eye behind that camera, and you get to know that person, how they see the world, so to speak. And you know, I think that. And isn't that amazing? Because they didn't paint it. They didn't even come up with it. I mean, let's say they took a picture of like a Volkswagen bus with two people standing outside of it. But it is. And how does that get to be in major galleries, you know, in black and white, mind you, in major galleries? Because it's conceptual, I guess.
Well, the thing is, you know, a real artist has a real signature regardless of the medium. The same is true of,
right,
you know, musician and writer. And that signature or that soul identity is coming out in the work. And if you take the time to educate yourself, to be aware of the work, then you can identify, you know, who the artist is, who the creator is.
That's magical. That's
it. It's incredible.
And you're not confused with any other artist.
Right. Exactly.
It's so authentic.
Exactly.
Yeah, that's I mean, with all the artists in the world, let's just talk, you know, paintings. You know, just paintings, acrylic or you know, oil, whatever. Just paintings alone. Look at all the artists that we've had on this planet, and no one, you know, no two are alike. It, like snowflakes. It's just amazing.
Well, and think about the creative and psychic energy that these people have contributed to our culture, our awareness, our spirits. And, you know, that's so much what we need right now. I just encourage everybody, I don't care what your creative form is, if you enjoy cooking and decorating your salads or crocheting or needlepoint or gardening, you know, just connect to your creative spark in some way, because, you know, we need that energy right now. We need
an hour already. And listen, before we get into the adopt an artist, because I really want to know all about that, you are listening to the Top Talk Show Revolution Radio. This is the top station out there on the internet for talk radio. And I want to thank all of you listeners, people in the chat room, and all those who have donated or purchased archives or what have you. I want to thank you for keeping us all on the air, because without you, that would be next to impossible. So I really want to thank you for your contributions of money. I mean, I don't know any other way to say it. You know, your donations have brought us this far, which to me, in my opinion, makes you part of the Revolution Radio family. You're just as important as I am, a host, or like Thomas, my producer, or people who are managing the station, etc. Everybody works so hard, and everybody's a volunteer. And you volunteering, you know, in your own way, audience, is via a donation, $1, $2, $5, whatever it is. It all helps. It all goes into the pot. So I will pass the hat around if I could and ask that if you could just keep us in mind, if you got a few extra dollars and you'd like to contribute, we will take your money. We will take your money, and this is what we'll do with your money. We'll keep the truth on the air. I believe we have over 65 hosts. I heard 68 yesterday on Sean Morton's show, I think. So, you know, this is a growing community. And you've sparked that and helped it to grow. So I look forward to more of you and meeting more of you as well in the future. And just want to say mahalo nui loa, which in Hawaiian means thank you very much for your contribution. So, Mia, you know, as far as adopt an artist goes, adopt an artist, does that have to do with somebody sponsoring an artist as well?
Actually, adopt an artist grew out of, in a sense, ARTWALK NY as an extension of the idea of bringing art to the public in an intimate way. And I started thinking about the fact that all these artists are, you know, stuck in their studios and would like to travel and don't necessarily have the means to do it. So a network is being created where, suppose you as a painter want to go to Barcelona to paint, we will hook you up with a family in Barcelona who has a guest room and also extra space that could be used as a studio, and you'll stay for an extended period of time and become part of the family and by extension the community. Give a talk on your art while you're there, a public talk on your art while you're there. And at the end of the stay, the family will choose a work of art that you made while you were in residence. It's taking the idea that, as in ancient Greece and Rome, art was integrated into daily life. Everything was beautiful. You know, a common vase or urn had, you know, extensive etching and, you know, figurative friezes, and aesthetics and philosophy and higher realms of thought were part of everyday life. People considered these things throughout the day, and their place within that consciousness was considered and debated and integrated in a way that 20th and 21st century man and woman has little time to do. And so the idea for me to bring art into the family, especially today where the arts are being slashed in the public school system across America, children are not being taught, you know, art, music, design. They're not being encouraged to think outside of the box in these particular areas. And they need to be. And interestingly enough, I know the show today was postponed to a later date, but my first conversation with you in early July, two of the people who contacted me, one is a woman in Europe who leads a foundation to help artists from the Middle East get scholarships to go to art school, an opportunity that they don't have where they live. And, you know, she's focusing on Iraq at the moment. And one of the things that the Adopt an Artist Project will do, and I actually met with a wonderful contemporary artist, Eric Aho, this morning, and he's about to have an opening at D.C. Moore Gallery, opening on October 10th. We talked about the whole idea of artists in the Renaissance and at other times being mentors and having apprentices work in their studio. So the Adopt an Artist program will actually have a certain segment where artists from the Middle East will be able to hook up with established artists in New York and the surrounding area, actually all over it once the program grows, and live with the artist and the artist's family, but also be an assistant and actually serve as an apprentice to the artist to learn about painting in or whatever the art form is, as opposed to spending $40,000 a year to go to art school. And because of the way things are in the economy, it you know, it doesn't have to be just about art where people do these apprenticeships to learn skills. You know, it's we're sponges. We learn by osmosis, and when we're around something, you know, see it being done firsthand, we pick it up, ideas develop, dialogues happen, we learn. And that, again, is going back to David Foster Wallace and This Is Water. You know, it's about awareness. It's about paying attention to what's going on around you. And so the Adopt an Artist program can really fill in this void as far as what's happening to the arts in our education system.
So it sounds like you're starting with, or she was starting with an area of Iraq that has no, there is no program there to sustain or teach or mentor artists. So obviously she's wanting to bring them, or they, or whoever's in charge of this, wants to bring them over here facilitate really the artists. And did they pick certain artists there, or do people in Iraq sign up for this? I mean, how do people in Iraq get chosen to be part of the Adopt an Artist program?
Well, we'll work with this foundation to identify them. At the moment, they've given scholarships to just a small handful of students. But part of this also is to bring creative people from the different factions in Iraq who are not getting along together, you know, to bring culture, to use the arts and culture as a means of building bridges and bringing people together, which, you know, makes total sense. And also bringing these artists to the States and having, you know, our citizens see that these are just wonderful people, wonderful creative people, you know, just like you and me, and they're not terrorists, and they didn't bomb the World Trade Center, and, you know, on and on and on. We just can't be such separatists anymore, and, you know, we Americans are perhaps the most guilty of, you know, taking advantage globally. And I've said this before, I really believe that the chickens are coming home to roost. And this program, you know, can extend an arm of friendship. And that's really what this is about. And, you know, I will say, surrounding my exhibition, I extended an arm of friendship and two olive branches, trying to make peace around this show. And the gift, which had a monetary value of $250, was accepted, but the lunch or coffee was rejected. And I just think that, you know, we all have to pay attention to our attitudes and what we're putting out in the world. But also, again, we have to be true to ourselves and be willing to stand up and say, no, this is not acceptable. This is not acceptable. So I think we're on a moment of change. I think we're in this place where things could go in multiple directions, you know, multiple timelines, and we all want to be as constructive and positive as possible. And using your word from our last talk, righteous, you know, really being righteous people with ourselves and the people in our lives, and just speaking our truth. And if that means speaking truth to power, then that's what we need to be doing too. So I'm thrilled to be, you know, working with this foundation and this wonderful woman who spearheaded it, and bringing artists from the Middle East to the States and elsewhere. And I very much hope to be able to go there next summer with the foundation and meet these artists and see them on their own turf.
I want people to imagine something as well. Congratulations on that. What a great co-creator you are. to be able to be a part of that, you know, and that's what we all are. And that's what I was going to ask. First, I wanted people to envision something, though. You said it earlier at the top of the hour. The way the subculture, like now it's a subculture, you know, art, music, wine, you know, whatever, you know, hanging out with a bunch of people by a fire, drinking wine and looking at art and listening to, you know, esoteric, you know, I don't know, having lots of books out and sharing them and sharing paragraphs and reading poetry and all the rest of it. You know, it really is a night to remember. And I've had many nights like that with people. Especially when I lived in Los Angeles and when I lived in Seattle. It's very that, because Seattle's very cold and it's rainy and it's overcast. And so you really actually get together with people and you just have talks, you know, and it's just so outside the box, and you just explore conversation and art and music and the rest of it for real. You know, you don't fit in a box.
Right.
A lot of my friends there didn't fit into any box. And it was inspiring for that very reason. It was so like living in the heart of Seattle, and Queen Anne is where I lived. Very difficult, because so many people there live outside the box. In other words, I was going to say it's very difficult to not to live in a box. Very difficult. No one lets you. You know, it's kind of freaky. Yeah, no one will let you. And they talk to you and about this, that, and the other thing, and make you think, and you're just standing there on a street corner, and they go, hey, have you ever noticed that little thing hanging from that building? And you're like looking at it going, what is that? I don't know. Have you ever noticed it? No, I didn't notice it. You know, they're real. And at the same time, people, Seattle lights are blamed for being like, you know, too inside themselves, you know, they're not very open. No, they really are. It's just the conversation has to be a certain type of conversation. When I first moved up there, my sister came up there like a couple weeks later from Hawaii, and she was like, she termed like all the people that lived in Queen Anne the village people. And I go, what does that mean? What's that mean? She said, the village people. What are you, like the band, the village people? No, they're like village people from like, you know, the Renaissance area or whatever. And I was like, right. You know, everyone's in dreadlocks and, you know, the whole nine yards. So, but what it is, you were describing it earlier, and I can just, when you started to talk about, we were surrounded by art, we were surrounded with the talk, we were surrounded with the conversation, and the music and the what have you, you know, that sparked something in me the minute, I mean, I had a vision immediately that you said that people in the 21st, 22nd, you know, don't have the ability to do anymore. We're too busy. We're too this, we're too that, which is ironic because we have more modalities now, you know, iPhones, iPods, cell phones. We have more modalities to show pictures, to paint pictures, to or art or photography or sharing it or music or whatever. We have more modalities now than we ever have, yet somehow we're not in it. And you said about the separatism, and I think that's huge. I think if you break up the subculture, and the subculture is art, it's all art, man. And if you break up the subculture and you separate it from the one that's above the ground, I mean, I don't know. It feels like hell. That would be hell to me if there were no arts.
It would absolutely be hell. And but you know, our technology, our devices, in a sense, manage us versus the other way around. For most people, you know, you're glued to your iPhone, you're glued to your cell phone, you're glued to your computer, and you're completely dependent on it. So take it away. Like, take everybody's cell phone away for a week. What happens? They're left to, you know, not check their text messages and their, you know, their emails. And, you know, at this point, many, many people would feel totally adrift at sea without being able to communicate with all the people that they think they're so connected to, yet in fact spend no time with.
right, exactly.
It's ironic.
What about the four, you know, people walking down the street all texting each other instead of just talking?
Right.
You know,
right.
Or sitting at, I mean, we're hearing that more and more, you know, coffee shops and diners and this and that, and four kids, you know, or whatever, sitting at a table and they're all texting each other, and it's just like, stop it. I actually had that happen to me a couple of years ago with a good friend of mine, and she knows I'm kidding if she's listening, but it was a couple of years ago, and we were basically doing a garage sale type of thing, and I got stuff out, you know, which is really fun. I love doing those. And she was texting me, and my phone kept going, brruh, brruh. And finally I said, "Is that you texting me?" And she started laughing, and I go, "Dude, I'm sitting right here." You know what I mean? It's like, don't do that. My husband won't even get texts on his phone. Doesn't even like to use the phone, the cell phone. So, you know, it is pretty interesting when you're saying this, because I think part of the arts is collectivism, and it is, I mean, to a certain degree, I suppose, you know, it could be, well, let's talk about this. This is a good segue. What are the divine outlaws?
The divine outlaws, outlaws are Dorian Miller and me. And, the main person who contacted me from my first, conversation with you on the air was Dorian Miller,
Let's talk about Dorian, because you were on the air. Hi, Dorian. I hope he's listening. Hi, Dorian. We love you. Now, this is really interesting. So you come on my show because, believe it or not, people, I just met Mia. When did we meet Mia? In June or maybe earlier?
May, I think. May.
Okay. That's when we met. And then, of course, between the two of us, we've met a ton of people. But here's what's interesting. So Mia comes on and does our first show, and you all remember that. You guys really dug that first show, because Mia was really a new sort of slant to things that we talk about generally on the show. And you guys dug her, and it was everything you needed to hear and so forth. But we did that show, and Dorian Miller, who lives in Canada, happened to be tuned into that show. And you tell the rest, Mia.
Well, he listened to it when you posted it on YouTube the next day, and he wrote to me right away, and we've been in continual communication ever since, and we have spent a fair amount of time together, but it's quite hilarious, because when I call him, it costs a fortune, but he has a plan where he can call me for free. So the first 5 weeks, I think we spent 12,000 minutes talking to each other.
Oh, no.
And he, among many other things, he's very gifted spiritually. He went to India as a 19-year-old, and we can communicate with each other on a very deep, profound level. But he's an extraordinarily gifted poet as well. And he has thousands of poems that he's written over the years. And what's very interesting is a number of them, which he wrote 10 years ago or even, you know, longer, they really have to do with me. They have to do with the two of us together. And an interesting thing happened, many interesting things happened between us, but his birthday is August 18th, and my father's birthday Dorian's birthday is August 16th. My father's birthday was August 18th, and my father and I were very close, and one of the things that I had that belonged to him was a silver lighter that my grandfather had given him on his birthday as a 20-year-old. And it had his birthday, August 18th, and it was dated 1946. He was born in 1926, and it said to George from Dad, or Love Dad. And it was one of the things that I gave Dorian for his birthday. And we were sitting in the living room, and he happened to notice that there was additional writing on the lighter. And he ran up and got a magnifying glass, and it actually said Canada 1952. It was the copyright expiration date, 1952, for the design of the lighter. And Dorian was born in Canada in 1952. And I had been prompted by my father to give the lighter to Dorian for his birthday, and he actually got it to spark that night. And, you know, it hasn't been used in decades. So, it was a very powerful experience.
I love when that stuff happens.
Yeah, me too.
It's exciting, isn't it? Off the air, I'll tell you about my silver lighter story. I can't believe you're saying this, because I had a very similar thing happen to me about 20 years ago. But let's move forward. This isn't about me. So the Divine Outlaws, now you're going to be launching art, right? And it's going to be called the Divine Outlaws, right?
The Divine Outlaws really has to do with the fact that...
I love the name, by the way. I want a t-shirt.
Actually, a t-shirt would be fantastic.
Right?
The Divine Outlaws really has to do with the fact that, we need to be outlaws. We need to find our tribe and stand up for ourselves and feel our own presence. Nobody's suggesting, that you go out and rob a bank, but that you do not accept the system for what it is, because the system is broken. It can't be fixed by the people who are currently running it. They don't have the perspective to do so. Their own self-interest is up front and center. And it's really us, the people. We elected them. They represent us because we put them there. And it's up to each of us.
I didn't elect them. I didn't vote for them either.
Yeah.
Don't blame me.
It's up to us collectively to stand together and create something new and better. And that's really the concept of being a divine outlaw is to follow your divine guidance, your own, inner prompting and express it, not be afraid to express it. And I have to say, getting back to This Is Water for just a minute, my exhibition, I know I can be a royal pain in the butt, but, I stood up for myself and, as far as I'm concerned, that was a work of art. That was an authentic work of art. Me saying, this is not acceptable. And then, having...
What wasn't acceptable? That they moved on without you or...
Well,
that
they basically, screwed me out of my consulting fee and took over something that I created and felt they had the right to do it, frankly, felt that they were entitled and able to do such a thing.
It'd be like walking up to, like somebody who just finished, a fresh painting. And the person leaves and goes to the store, and the other person walks up to the painting and signs their name to it and sells it and says, yeah, that's my art. It's the same
that's
thing.
Exactly, that's exactly the it, same
it's
thing.
It's like hijacking because... who you are and it's hijacking the whole thing, your idea, the concept of it, the putting together of the artist, the relationship you have with those artists, the credibility that you have to be able to put exhibitions together, and that these people just came right along and just like pulled the rug out from under you. And how many people are listening right now that can relate to this on many different levels? I mean, how do you think 800,000 people feel today?
Right.
800,000 government workers, didn't go to work today and just went like somebody just like changed their whole frickin' reality.
Right.
And that's not cool because you and me, we the people, we didn't approve that. It's the assholes in, sorry, didn't mean to swear, but, in Washington.
And not just in Washington.
Wherever they are. For all I know, they're like on the moon doing all of this stuff. For all I know, they already bailed on the planet or they're in underground, deep underground bases or whatever. I don't care where they are. They're just there doing the wrong thing. You know what I mean? And they're getting paid to do it. See, this is what kills me. Don't get me going, Mia.
Yeah, no, it's
right?
They're getting
paid big bucks to close the government.
Yeah.
I'm really stuck on that today, but today was the first day. I mean, this is history in the making. I guess they closed the government 18 years ago. I personally don't remember that. Do you?
Yes, I do. When Gingrich did all of this stuff. Yeah. But I also want to say there's a wonderful article by Chris Hedges called Sparks of Rebellion that's available on Truthdig, and he talks about, you know, different writers like Lenin,
right,
who, you know, who sparked ideas. He sparked ideas that caused, you know, real cultural and sociological change to happen in the 20th century. And that's exactly what we need right now. But, you know, if everyone for a day or a week or a month just says, I'm not doing this, I'm not, you know, I'm not paying the bills, I'm not supporting the system, you know, we have to band together whatever it is we decide to do, and we simply have to do it, because otherwise this is just going to continue until there's nothing left. And we are in a place where the, you know, the energy, the portal is open. There's enough unrest. And I'm not, you know, speaking to revolution. I don't own a gun. I don't want to own a gun. No matter what happens, I will not go out and purchase one. You know, we have our minds. We have our souls. We have our, you know, everything that makes up, you know, our personal individual characters. And we need to just join together with find our tribe, join together with like-minded souls,
right,
and make a difference. Make a difference, but get, you know, off the couch and away from the TV set and just do something. And I do want to read actually one of Dorian's poems, which I feel is so pertinent because it's so uplifting. And it's just,
oh, I just want to make a mention real quick. About 4 minutes ago, we were supposed to have a break, and I don't know where the break went, because we didn't have a break. So if anybody knows, are we supposed to just keep going? I guess we're supposed to just keep talking, but there was no break, and I think that's very cool.
Oh.
There is no break,
interesting.
But yeah, but then I didn't want you to start to read it, and then we all of a sudden a break comes up. So
thank you, Roxy. So,
I know, you know what I'm saying. So
yeah.
I don't know what's going on. I'm trying to ask Thomas here. He says, I guess there isn't a break. So, okay, go ahead.
Okay.
Yes, and I want you to read this poem. It's awesome. Go ahead.
The name of the poem.
Dorian Miller.
This is by Dorian Richard Miller. The name of the poem is To See Them Happy. To see them happy is all we care about, the we who know such happiness, the we who gave our hearts back to the world. Happy at last to be unfettered, at last and free from afterthought. Happy to receive the deed to ultimate ownership, the true landlord of our creation. I have heard it said again today, I am so thrilled to see them happy, and it reverberated through flawless eternity. Just happy to see everything around you, blooming, thriving, prospering, advancing, well-nourished with clear blood and complexion, magnetic, slow to anger, transmuting trouble through heart waves, gathering love from all you meet, not talking so much as listening, and impressive only by direct presence. To see them happy the world over, arm in arm as we have been arm in arm on our mystic sojourns. Every plant and animal and insect, the rocks, trees, the feet of humanity, everything happy to be itself and happy to be everything else. There lies the mystery, how meanness and agony extend to victory, how we live in time till we can vibrate in stillness, faster than light could ever travel, except for uncreated light. Parentheses, is it time for a break, an experience of joy inconceivable? We have time. There is no rush. It is guaranteed, and we know it. End of parentheses. Dorian wrote that on September 9th, 2013.
And tell us what inspired it.
He wrote it to my muse. We were having a conversation about his little dog Zoe, and we were talking about her. She was out in the backyard. We were on the phone together one morning, and I said, I was talking about my animals too, and I said, I'm so thrilled, you know, to see them happy. And of course he extended it out to people, which, you know, we all want to be happy. We deserve to be happy. And, you know, we're not going to be happy until we're respected, and we are not being considered or respected in the way that we should be, as people and, certainly as citizens. And it's time that we address that issue. You know, we're afraid of losing whatever it is we think we have, but the truth of the matter is, with the NDAA and all the other new things that Obama has signed into effect, they can come and take whatever it is you have, you know, at any moment if they decide that they need it, you know, for their own use. And so what do we actually own? And then, you know, the as you say, Roxy, the monetary system is being manipulated and crashed, and so they can, you know, abscond with 40 or 50 or 60% of our money if that's what they decide that they want to do. It's time that the people took the power back and, you know, got together and mobilized, just like we did in this country with the civil rights movement. You know, energetically, we're back where we were astrologically as well in the 60s. You know, that aspect, that energy has come around again, and it's time for us to bring it home, to bring it to fruition and actually make use of it in a way that that will really change things and not just put a Band-Aid on situations. And you know, that's what we're being called to do now. And that's what you do with your show, Roxy. That's, you know, what we're all committed to doing, because truthfully, we have no choice.
Well, I mean, as far as having a choice or no choice, I mean, I don't know about that. I mean, I'd rather be spending my energy doing what I'm doing than being completely in the dark. Although some days I'll argue that ignorance can be bliss.
I know what you mean, but it doesn't last long.
Ignorance can be bliss. But, you know, I love that poem. And the first time you ever read it to me, over the phone, I loved it. I think you sent it in an email. That's what it was. And I just thought, man, and then I think you read it to me and whatever. All I'm saying is that, see, poetry, even it's just another level. It's not the normal exchange of words. See, you know, poetry is a different, I don't know. I used to go to, what are those things called where you go to like a little club and then they read poetry readings, I guess.
Oh yeah. Yeah.
I guess that's what it's called. I used to go to those in Seattle all the time. There's none of them anywhere near me. See, that's another thing where I live. There's no arts. There's no nothing. I don't know. There's cows and GMO corn. No, I'm sorry. GMO cotton and GMO corn. Anyway, but yeah, I'm a little bit out of my element here, but as far as that goes, and maybe I need to bring the arts here. Maybe that's what I need to do. But, you know, I used to just be like dumbfounded. You know, the oddest looking people get up behind that mic, you know, that was feeding back and echoing, sounding all strange. But they'd start to read and like everybody be quiet. And they go off on something, and I go, wow, man, they have so much passion.
Right.
Like, you know, whatever they were saying, even if it was like, you know, just talking like this and like this and like this, the words, they were so energetic. And I just thought, wow, you know, I never really went to those things thinking, oh, God, you know, sit around and listen to poetry. I don't think I can handle it. But, man, I dug it. It was just as good as going to see, you know, Jimi Hendrix jam or something like that. Well,
I was just thinking of Jimi Hendrix and Glenn Wallach.
You know what I'm saying? Glenn Wallach, exactly. Yeah. Exactly. Hi, Glenn Wallach. And so, yeah, the inspiration behind it, you know, again, in creativity. And you know, I know that you probably will agree that we're all creators. We are. That's it. That's what we came here to be. That's what we came here to do. And like you said earlier, you know, cooking or making a garden or whatever. I mean, God, it's really, really true. I mean, it's just like Thomas, my producer, was showing me, you know, a picture that he did, you know, and we talked about that at the, you know, the top of the first hour, you and I and Thomas, and it's like, I'm looking at it and he's taking me into like another world. By the way, really good stuff. I'm going to send you a link to it after the show. But, you know, I'm also looking at Eric, is it Aho or Aho?
Yes, Eric Aho. Isn't he? Aho. He's a great painter.
Man, these pictures of the glacial
yeah.
night.
Yeah.
Really like those. Those are fantastic. Anybody that wants to go ahead and take a look at these, you know, again, very inspiring, you know. Do you think there was a time where humans were got art, music, like all the creative arts? Do you think there was a time where that was just normal?
Well, look at the cave paintings. Look at our earliest art forms, the cave paintings, and how extraordinarily contemporary they are, and the things that they paid attention to. You know, the animals they chose to draw, horses, or, you know, play a predominant role image-wise. Look how extraordinarily beautiful they are, and the caves in Lascaux, France, the detail, you know, the things that they chose to focus on, you know, in their drawings and paintings, the color, you know, the fact that these things have survived for, you know, thousands and thousands of years, but they're, you know, their real authenticity, you know, they're as fresh today as they were the day that they were made. And I think there is an innate desire and need in each of us, regardless of, you know, where we were at, you know, based on, you know, what time we were living in, the Ice Age or the Italian Renaissance, or even today. I think man has a tremendous desire to communicate, whether it's spoken word or visual or just
right
music, grunting. You know, it's so interesting. You mentioned Ruby earlier, and all six of the dogs were living, one of my favorite times was when the coyotes would start singing, and my pack would sing back to them, and I could pick out each of their voices. But Ruby, even when she barks, has the most melodious voice. Everyone who hears her says it, because it's not like a dog bark. She actually, you know, it's musical. She's actually singing. And she expresses joy, you know, through her voice and, you know, hits all these different notes. You know, so even the animal, you know, you see a dog watch a sunset, there's no question that the dog is experiencing beauty and watching the sunset. So
I think animals expect it.
Yes.
I mean, that's all they know. You know what I mean?
Yes.
That's all they know.
Right.
I think that's, I mean, thank God for nature, and thank God for, you know, the animals in the wild, or the bugs, or all of it, the birds and whatever, birds, bees, and trees, so to speak, because that's, you know, that's all part of us, you know. And I think, you know, I've heard a lot of different opinions lately on what people actually think is going on in the world, and some of them are not very inspiring, so I listen, I'm open-minded, but it doesn't inspire me. And do you think that even in times of revolution and even in times of major change on the planet, isn't it inspiration that keeps us going? Isn't everything, like, I guess what I'm trying to say, like, isn't revolution, wasn't that an inspiration? Or was it somebody was telling me that, you know, we just do things out of need, and we just do things to adapt, and we'll just adapt and adapt and adapt and adapt. But it, as an outside of the box thinker, I don't think like that at all.
No, I don't either. And I think looking at the 20th century and the amount of bloodshed that happened unnecessarily, was we were feeding our base, you know, lowest level characteristics and motivations, and we've come to this place where everything has to be heart centered. And when you move into your heart chakra, your choices become totally different, because your impulses are different. You're connected to a different part of yourself. You're not in this aggressive, you know, willed solar plexus level. You've moved it up, and then once you get to the heart chakra, you know, all your other chakras can just open up immediately. But I I think based on, and I feel very strongly, it's not just thinking, I see it in myself and in the world around me. You know, when I'm in that heart chakra place, you know, the beauty is I don't have to even, extend my arm to touch it. It's everywhere. It just is permeating out of me, but it's reflected back to me and everyone and everything I see and interact with. And, you know, we have to remember that when we're being abused or someone is, you know, truly nasty to us, just remind yourself that, you know, you went through your own stages of evolution to get to where you are. And, you know, we have to allow others to go through their own evolutionary process as well. And to take solace in that, to know that they're in the struggle. But the 21st century does not need to be about bloodshed. We've done that enough. We see that it doesn't work. It doesn't need to be about drones. It doesn't need to be about white phosphorus and dirty bombs and all this, you know, shit that we're doing to each other. And the only way we can stop this is for each of us to choose to get involved, you know, in your immediate community and then beyond. If it means, you know, all of us who are aware of this and all your friends and your neighbors going to Washington, D.C., then so be it. You know, let's go to Washington, D.C., because we can't keep living like this. We just can't. I mean, it's broken. Our food is poisoned. You know, half of the population's on medication for depression or you know, something else. We need to be making decisions so that we can create a sustainable community, a sustainable country, and a sustainable world. And nobody's going to do it for us. You know, we are it.
Well, yeah, you know, and see, you're making so much sense, because I think that, you know, by saying, well, we'll adapt, or, you know, it'll change, it, as if it is like this thing, like that you just turn it on and it fixes itself. You know what I mean? Like, it's so minor. I think we said that for too long. Like, oh, they'll do something and they'll change it. These New World Order globalists, whatever you want to call them. I mean, I don't even know what to call them anymore, because they're everywhere.
Well, these corporations, you know, the corporations are now people.
I mean, they will, you know, and people say, well, what about their children and what about their lineage and what about this and what about that? What about it? These guys, you want to talk about people who live in the moment?
Yeah,
they'll fire this place up. They don't really have. They have, to me, they have lost the grasp or the opportunity to even be a part of the human race anymore. I mean, really, seriously, they live in a completely separate reality. I mean, that is a fact. They live in a completely separate reality, and that's cool if they want to live in a completely separate reality, but man, don't rain your crap on us. Like, don't make it harder and harder and harder on us, right?
Well, they live in their gated communities, and they live privileged lives, and, you know, we all bleed, you know, under the skin. Theoretically, we're all the same. So, you know, one would think that they would want a better life for their own children and grandchildren. But at this point, honestly, it doesn't matter, you know, what they want. What matters is what we want, and what matters is what we're prepared to do about it. Are we prepared to organize? Are we prepared to make a stand? Are we prepared to be divine outlaws and be true to what we really believe and you know, not be afraid to voice that opinion and demand respect? Because really, that's what this is all about, you know, to be respected as your birthright, as a human being, and that should be enough to be able to receive respect.
Yeah. There's a lot going on, and there's a lot of diversion from the we, the people of the planet. wanting what we want. You know, I mean, for the longest time in our country, citizens here would say, you know, but we are the freest country on earth. And up until a few, like 5 years ago, maybe, that actually worked. It worked for me. I'd say, yeah, we do have a lot of freedom here, you know, blah, 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 blah. The perception of other countries looking at us right now are saying, you know, we do. We have more freedoms than a lot of other countries do. They see us as, but then you've got the places like Belize and Ecuador and a number of other countries, you know, Chile, Costa Rica. You've got countries that people are freer than us. And that used to not, you know, used to not. That's not English.
It's more free. It's totally true, but there's also a renaissance going on in those countries on a lot of levels too.
Well, yeah, I mean they reverted back too, and you know what? I don't want to be responsible for conquering the world with the American flag, the way, you know,
right.
This way. I don't want that. You know, I hear about Ecuador, like how the prices of land and real estate in general are going up because the Americans. And the people in, and nothing against the UK at all, but they're going down there and making that happen, raising the prices, and they don't want it, and they're trying to do something about, you know, those who govern, you know, Ecuador. I mean, everywhere we go, that's the other thing. You know, every time I see something on like a documentary, and it's this beautiful country and island living and this and that, and once we discover it, we ruin it.
Right.
Like that. What the hell?
Well, imperialism, you know, continues to reach for and gobble up, you know,
yes.
Anything and everything that it doesn't.
That's why a lot
go
has
over.
To change. A lot
yes.
has to change.
A lot has to change.
You know, I was born and raised in Hawaii a million years ago, right? And so when I was there, you know, there was a couple of hotels in Waikiki Beach, no lie. And if anybody has been to Hawaii, you know, and on Oahu, especially, you know, anytime in the last 20 years, you'll see that it's Miami. It's Miami, Florida, you know, Waikiki Beach. So, you know, I've watched what other countries, you know, and that was an Asian influence, and that was, you know, money, just ruining like beautiful land, beautiful areas.
It's awful. It's absolutely awful. It's heartbreaking. But they've been allowed to run amok, you know, they really have. And we have an opportunity here. We have a window, and we have to organize. It's that simple, you know, using, I always go back to Eyes on the Prize, The History of Black America, which was produced by Henry Hampton, who was a friend of mine. His sister Viva was my oldest and closest friend, and I remember when Henry was putting Eyes together, and the entire documentation of the civil rights movement, the actual footage, can be seen watching Eyes on the Prize, and you see just average people, you know, getting together and standing up for themselves. And you know, Fannie Lou Hamer at the Democratic Convention in Chicago in 1968 and demanding to be counted, demanding
right.
to be, you know, she stood up and she said her piece and demanding to be counted. And this is what each of us has to do, regardless of our, you know, race, color, or creed. It's time to make a stand. And it's all there, you know, in the civil rights footage, you know, of actual people that many of us, you know, were alive and watched this on the evening news. And we had, you know, Lyndon Johnson was many things, but Lyndon Johnson was, you know, the ultimate politician, and he knew how to build consensus. He knew how to get things done. And you know, he really, you know, he's responsible for so much in terms of signing the Civil Rights Bill into effect. And you know, I mean, many feel that he was responsible for the death of John Kennedy, too.
I was just going to say,
yeah. But you know, but in terms of working, you know, at least for a number of years with Martin Luther King, he really did do that, and he knew it was the right thing, even though he came from a southern state and undoubtedly was prejudiced. It's time for us to work together and put our differences aside and make the necessary changes that we need to see.
Yeah, and you're right. When you say about eyes on the prize, it's ordinary people putting ideas together. So, you know, I know that my husband wouldn't mind going, you know, with a bunch of, you know, our local, he's got a lot of biker friends here. We wouldn't mind going on like some big, you know, Harley chain gang up to DC either. You know what I mean? And just going and camping out and meet a lot of people who've been on the show, as a matter of fact, that all live up there within blocks of, you know, the Capitol. So, I mean, there's lots of things we can do. We don't even have to do it with a bunch of other people. We can go up, we can write our little signs, go up there. I mean, it's just a constant influx of people saying no more. You know, of course, in groups it works out. And then, you know, at the other end of that spectrum, you know, in Egypt, a lot of people got killed because they just stayed out there in the streets, just like in Brazil there. They stayed out in the streets. They're continuing to stay out in those streets until change is happening. And there's a lot of different ways to do it. I like your way. I like that you are representing artists. I like that you're part of different artist retreat type things, or inspiring artists, giving them what they need, apprenticeship, if you will, and all the rest of it. I think it's very important. And you know what, Mia, you're doing your part. And at the end of the day, Mia, that's not all you do. You have a full spectrum of knowledge and people that you know, my audience doesn't know, but that you work with to make the world a better place.
Well, I think we all have that capability, Roxy. And you know, I just want to get back to Martin Luther King for a minute. The last project
that's
that
all
he
we
worked,
have is a minute. We've got
okay,
a minute.
Before he did though, was his poor man's march on Washington and the end of the Vietnam War. So I just ask everybody who's listening to this, you know, to spend a half an hour and figure out what it is that you can do personally to make a contribution to you know, getting the ball rolling.
What do you think the most powerful thing, if you, just off the cuff, that Martin Luther King said?
I have a dream.
Mm. Nice.
And so did John Lennon.
True. Well, somebody said something really, really cuckoo on TV last night. They said, somebody said, you know, well, don't you want to achieve your dream? And the person said, well, dreams aren't real. That's why they call them dreams.
Huh.
I know. And I'm sitting there watching. This is our youth. This is somebody.
Wow.
This is our youth saying this. Well, dreams aren't real. That's why they call them a dream, stupid.
And well, that's because they're so disenfranchised, because they have nothing to look for, very little to look forward to, because it's all been taken away from them.
Right, right, right. Exactly. Do you think?